प्रकाश वारुण जी की सर हैज कंप्लीटेड हिज बीएसएल एलएलबी डिग्री फ्रॉम द पुणे यूनिवर्सिटी इन द ईयर 1994 विद फर्स्ट क्लास एंड देयर आफ्टर कंप्लीटेड हिज एलएलएम इन ईयर 1996 फ्रॉम मुंबई यूनिवर्सिटी सर होल्ड्स डिप्लोमा इन टैक्सेशन एंड लेबर लॉस डॉक्टर वारुण जी कर सर हैज बीन अवार्डेड पीएचडी डिग्री इन ईयर 2019 from Savitribai Phule University at Pune on the topic of gender justice, human rights and preconceptional and prenatal diagnostic techniques at 1994. With such great academics, sir was also involved in teaching in colleges for about 5 years. Sir has completed about 26 years of credential practice before the Honorable Bombay High Court and has successfully handled more than 14,000 cases, which include public interest litigation, namely relating to the implementation of provisions of persons with disability, implementation of biomedical waste rules, environmental issues relating to noise, water and air pollution, complex issues of unauthorized construction and encroachment, issues relating to right of women. It is a pleasure to add that Dr. Varanjikar sir has authored Marathi books besides legal column in dailies like Sakal and Lok Satta. Participation on legal issues in various forums like talk shows, TV and All India Radio. Dr. Varunjikar sir also has been a resource person for training of judicial officers in Maharashtra state between the year 2010 to 2015. Sir has been recipient of Ethical Legal Practitioner Award from Trans Asia, Ami Satarkar, an award from Mumbai Grahak Panchayat for valuable contribution in protection and promotion of consumer rights. Sir has submitted a research paper on interaction of secular family law and religion in June 2016 at the International Conference at Hong Kong. He has also been a participant as a member of the Indian delegate in the Law Conference at Berlin, Germany, at Colombo, Sri Lanka, and at Law Asia Conference in Sydney, Australia. In year 2018, Sir has been a speaker as member of Indian delegate at BRICS Legal Forum in Russia on the subject need for establishment of International Commercial Arbitration Center and at South Africa on the subject India against terrorism in framework of Constitution of India. Sir also has been holding various designations, like he has been a member of Expert Committee for Cyber Law, Panel Advocate on the Legal Aid Panel, ex-Vice President of Advocates Association of Western India, President of Consumer Court Association Maharashtra, Vice President, Bar Association of India, Delhi, member on advisory board under Right of Persons with Disabilities Act 2016, member of Committee for Framing Standard Operating Procedures under Transfer of Human Organs Act, member on Panel of Cooperative Societies Act 1966. He has been appointed by Maharashtra State as a committee member for formulation of standard operating procedures under Transplantation of Human Organs Act. He has also been the member to amend the preconceptional and prenatal diagnostic techniques rules. Sir is presently elected member of Bar Council of Maharashtra and Goa. Such his achievement list goes on and on. My friends, I'm sure that with such strengths of our resource person, Advocate Dr. Uday Prakash Varunjikar sir, we all will be best guided today on the complex subject of interpretation of statutes. Without wasting much time, I, on behalf of Bar Council of Maharashtra and Goa and all of us here, welcome sir for having consented to spare his time and request sir to take over and guide us on the importance and use of interpretation of statutes in our regular practice. Thank you, sir. Please take over.
Namaskar. Can I see the, I can see some volunteers are there, but I am unable to see the PPT which is prepared. Can any volunteer reply whether PPT is visible to them?
Sir, we are sharing it. We are sharing it in 2 minutes, sir.
Have you started?
Yes, it's starting. It's 2 minutes, sir.
All right. As soon as I see the first slide, I will start. Till that point of time, let me welcome all my young friends who are on that side. During this pandemic situation, this is a novel concept which has been introduced by the Bar Council of Maharashtra and Goa. I, being one of the members out of those 25 persons, I feel privileged to say, and with a sense of honor, that it is the state of Maharashtra and more particularly Bar Council of Maharashtra and Goa who has introduced such innovative method. The young lawyers who have enrolled themselves just now, they are the persons who need some kind of a guidance, some kind of a expertise training, some kind of a revision of the subjects. Let us understand, there is a gap between the theory and the practical. So therefore, this is a one of the way how we can bridge that gap. As soon as all of you become lawyer, I'm sure you are ready to wear your black coat and the gown and the white band. But that is not enough. The people at large or the society at large feels that you are now a student of law who knows how to use the skill of being a lawyer. So therefore, now my simple appeal to all young friends who are on that side, please use pen, please use pencil, please take down the whatever best possible notes. Now you are aware that you are not in the college. As a result of that, you will have to take down the notes of whatever point, whatever topic which is convenient to you, which is suitable to you, or whichever is important to you. This is not a traditional lecture in which I'm going to dictate something, but this is a sharing of a thought. And if you find something important, you may note down. But as a person who is having around 26 years of practice and standing at Bombay High Court and the other courts, I can give a word of advice that most of the this session will be helpful to you for your day-to-day practice. Volunteer, can you inform me whether the PPT is ready? Volunteer, can you inform me whether PPT is ready? Usually as a speaker, we are having a habit of sharing our thoughts in front of the gathering. And this pandemic situation has created such a situation that I am supposed to speak in front of my own laptop. So I am speaking to the friends who are on that side, but I am unable to know whether they are receiving it. I'm asking once again, volunteers.
No, sir. Sir, it is loading, sir. In exactly one minute, sir.
All right. Till that point of time, let me add something general about this topic. There is a BLEP committee. This is known as a Basic Legal Education Program. In the BLEP committee, I was asked to speak on this topic, I thought it's a wonderful occasion to go back to the statute book and refresh myself. I went back to my college days, and I'm very proud to share that at that point of time, I scored, I think, 68 or 78 marks in this topic, namely the interpretation of statute. But during this pandemic situation, all my books, all my notes are left in my office, which is in the Fort area in Mumbai. And of course, being a red zone area, there are restrictions. And therefore, though I'm hardly around 12 kilometers away from my office, I'm unable to open my office. Therefore, I decided to prepare a PPT for all my young friends. And I shared it with one of the volunteers. So therefore, this will be one of the different approach for the interpretation of statute. I must say this PPT is prepared on the basis of whatever the principles which I am able to recollect, whatever the examples which I am able to recollect. As soon as the pandemic situation is over and those restrictions are removed, I can get an access to the books, library notes which we have prepared in last several years, and then I'm sure there can be one more better version of a presentation on interpretation of statute. Ganesh? Sujit? All All right. It seems some more time is required for uploading that. But nonetheless, in the meantime, let me proceed further, because ultimately this is a very, very important tool of a practicing advocate. You have enrolled with Bar Council of Maharashtra and Goa. So therefore, now there is a presumption that you are going to be a litigation lawyer. As a litigation lawyer, you will have to argue on behalf of your litigant. You will have to represent the case of your own client. While presenting that case, as well as while making the foundation of that case, if you know the basic principles of interpretation of statute, then I'm sure that will be helpful to you, and that way, that can be a one more added tool for presenting your case or presenting the case of your client in a positive manner. Let me ask you a simple question. Why organizers like Bar Council of Maharashtra and Goa had chosen this topic as a fifth lecture? We are aware that in the last week, there were four lectures in which civil procedure code, criminal practice, then the third lecture about, the fourth lecture about the Domestic Violence Act, all these lectures were conducted. So in all, after four lectures, why this topic has been chosen? There is some kind of a thought behind that. You have completed LLB. You are having some kind of elementary knowledge. Now the question comes, how to use that elementary knowledge which you have acquired from your law schools for the welfare or for the benefit of the litigant who is going to stand behind you. So therefore, these are the methods how you can use the skills for the benefit of your own litigant client. So these are the methods how, or these are the rules, these are the tricks, these are the principles which are required to be applied. And these principles can be applied during your day-to-day activities in the court of law. Yes, Sujit is sharing. Yes. Now, let us start. This is the first slide, interpretation of statute. Please go to the next one. Now let us try to find out what are the different definitions and what is the meaning of the word interpretation of statute. In simple language, it can be said that it is a systematic study of the rules of interpretation. As I said that we are now student of law, we are having a basic knowledge of law. So therefore, this is a systematic study of rules of interpretation. It is also mean that interpretation of statute means explanation, meaning, translation, exposition of the statute or enacted law or the law passed by the legislature. Now here there is a word of caution. This interpretation of statute will be applicable to the laws which are enacted or laws which have been passed by the legislature and legislature only. Now as a student of law, we are aware that there are some customary laws. There are other different laws which are other than the legislative laws, other than the enacted laws. Interpretation of statute is usually not applicable to the other field of law. We are aware that there are different sources of law. So therefore, qua the other sources, qua the other types of the law, this particular tool, this particular rule, namely interpretation of statute, is usually not made applicable. To interpret means to show or make clear or translate or explain the meaning of. So that's a meaning one in the other word, that what is required to be done so far as the interpretation of statute is concerned. Next one. This is a general meaning. So therefore, let us try to find out what the experts have said about this. So therefore, we are aware about the expert by name Salmond. Salmond has defined interpretation of statute as a process by which the courts seek to ascertain the meaning of the legislature through the medium or authoritative forms in which it is expressed. We are aware that our Indian legal system is influenced by the British legal system, and as a result of that, the field of interpretation of statute is also dominated by the British rule, or the European rules, I can say, which are usually treated as the sources for knowledge and information so far as interpretation of statute is concerned. So Salmond, one of the eminent jurists, has defined, which I read out. There is an eminent jurist by name Blackstone. He says that the fairest and the rational method for interpreting a statute is by exploring the intention of the legislature through the most natural and probable sign, which are either the words, the context, the subject matter, the effect and consequences, or the spirit and the reasons of law. Blackstone is, of course, not from the same legacy. So therefore, he is different. He is pointing out a different angle. He is saying that which are the different rather important methods which can be utilized for the purpose of interpretation of statute. He says that the words used in the statute, the context in which the words are used, the subject matter of the statute can be useful. The effect and the consequences of that statute can be useful. The spirit and the reasons of the law can also be used as a mechanism or a method to find out what was the will of the legislature. Next, please. Now you will find there are different jurists who have said accordingly, but the question comes why. One more slide before that. Before that. There is a need for interpretation. Yes. Please go down after the eminent jurist. Yes. As I was telling that, I was sharing that why there is a need for interpretation. We are aware that the laws are made by the legislators. Legislators are not the persons who are expert in the field of law. There will be a legislative draftsman in the legislative wing of the center or the state. Those are the persons who are specialized, having a special knowledge, but they are also human beings. So there is a possibility that they may try to convey a particular meaning by using a particular legal language or a technical language. And the legislators, while debating and discussing about that particular bill, they may come to different conclusion also. So looking at that situation, that scenario, the interpretation becomes one of the important method. And therefore, this is one of the method by virtue of which we can say that ultimately we people are benefited. The judges are also benefited. The law students are also benefited. Next slide, please. This is about the need of the interpretation. The interpretation is useful because the language conveys a different meaning. The language of a statute, the words, the phrases which are used can convey different meaning. We are aware that if two words are arranged in a particular manner, then they may convey a different meaning. If those words are arranged individually, take a case that there is an individual word which is arranged in a statute book, and if it is along with another book, then they may convey a different meaning. So these are the certain tests which are made applicable for years together. So therefore, for more than 150 or around 200 years, we can say that this law is getting developed. This is one of the field which is known as the interpretation of statute. I must say, you will not get any bare act of interpretation of statute. Why? Bare act means an act which is passed by the legislators. But the interpretation of statute is a practice, is a outcome of the different principles which have been applied from time to time. Like in the first lecture, you have come across Civil Procedure Code. In another lecture, you have come across principles of criminal practice. You have come across another lecture about the domestic violence laws. So these are the different laws which you have already understood. As a student of law in the law school, you have already seen the basics of the theory of those legislations. Now the time comes how to convert that particular piece of legislation into actual practice. And for that particular purpose, there is a need to understand how you can use this tool, namely interpretation of statute. Next, please. We are aware that we have adopted a democratic pattern in India. As a result of that, in the democratic pattern, we are aware that there are three different pillars, namely legislature, executive, and the judiciary. We are aware that in our constitution, there is a check and balance theory which has been introduced and which has been recognized in a world at large. this particular theory contemplate that no organ will become a become supreme, because if any of the organ becomes supreme in the implementation of the democratic principles, then that will be a threat to the public at large or to the democracy. Therefore, what is the job of the legislature? Legislatures are supposed to enact the law. What is the job of the executive? Executive is supposed to execute those laws. And what is the job of the judiciary? Judiciary is supposed to interpret those laws. Next, please. Now you will find what is the role of judiciary vis-a-vis the interpretation of statute. Interpretation of statute is a exclusive privilege of the constitutional court. Namely, the courts are the authority who can interpret the law. So therefore, this is one of the privilege of the constitutional court. Why constitutional court? Because our scheme of the constitution says that Article 215 of the constitution says that the high court will be a court of record. Likewise, there is a provision in the constitution which says that Supreme Court is a law of record. So therefore, these are the courts which are known as a constitutional courts, and they are having a privilege of interpretation of statute. Does that mean that the trial court or the district courts cannot interpret the statute? Sorry, that is not correct. So in other words, these are the functions of the court. They will have to interpret the statute. But so far as the privilege is concerned, that is with reference to the constitutional court. The primary role of the judiciary is to analyze, interpret, and then adjudicate upon the dispute. Next slide, please. Name, in other words, so far as the judiciary is concerned, judiciary is supposed to analyze the facts, apply the rule, and then while applying the rule, at the time of adjudication, they are supposed to interpret that particular law, and therefore they need a tool which is known as the interpretation of statute. Likewise, we can see what is the object of interpretation: to ascertain and give effect to the intention of the legislation expressed or imputed. Let us understand this in a couple of minutes. Usually, it is a phrase which has been used for years together, that we will have to find out what was the intention of the legislature. As a student of law, we will have to find out what was passing in the mind of the legislatures when the act was enacted. If we are aware about that, then we can find out what is required to be done with reference to that particular issue or those particular facts which are before us. So therefore, the intention can be express intention. Namely, there can be a penal statute. If there is a penal statute like Indian Penal Code, then Indian Penal Code, the intention of the legislature is very specific. But so far as the implied intention is concerned, there are other different legislations where you will find some provisions are made with reference to the penal aspect. I can give an example of Consumer Code. Consumer Protection Act is an act which is intended to protect the rights of the consumer. But if somebody fails to comply with the order or a direction issued by the consumer forum or the state commission, then in that eventuality, there is a penalty which is provided. So therefore, this becomes an implied intention of the legislator. So therefore, now, as I said, to ascertain, the object of interpretation is to ascertain and give effect to the intention of the legislature. Interpretation depends on the text and the context. As I pointed out, that the text is a mix. That particular word in a different language, or the meaning will be different. Take a case that we are a Maharashtrian, we are in Marathi. Marathi is a official language from 1965 in the state of Maharashtra. And I believe and I trust that all participants who are on that side of this or the Marathi language. So we are aware that if there is some little change which is made in the grammar of Marathi, then the context of that entire sentence changes. The text will be same, but if you change a simple grammar, if you change a little punctuation, then again the context of that particular sentence change. So therefore, what is a object of the interpretation? Object of the interpretation is to find out what, in what text the sentence was, in what context the sentence was, as well as the what color was used by the person, namely the legislator. Next slide, please. So these are the simple information with reference to the interpretation of statute. Now let us come to one slide which will tell us what are the general methods. Now general method of interpretation of statute is General Clauses Act 1897. I am sure you are not familiar with this law. I'll tell you very frankly and very honestly, most of the lawyers in the state of Maharashtra are not aware about any such law. Why? Because there are very, very rare examples to go and visit this statute book. So therefore, my appeal to all of you, write down a homework for you. General Clauses Act 1897. After this entire session is over, please download the General Clauses Act 1897. I'm not saying 1997. You people, you have registered in the year January 2000, you must be familiar with the 1997. No, this is 100 years prior to your birth. So therefore, this is 1897. During that British period, there was a General Clauses Act which was enacted. This act gives us a general method how a statute is required to be interpreted. But as I said that this act was during the British period, so therefore after getting the independence, there are different state General Clauses Act also. Like state of Maharashtra has also enacted a General Clauses Act for the state of Maharashtra. Likewise, there are other state General Clauses Act which are useful for interpretation of those legislations which have been enacted by the different states also. Now, this is going to be an important general method because this gives us a definition of different terminologies. This also lays down a general principle as to how a law is required to be interpreted. This also tells us what are the ways how a law is required to be made applicable. So therefore, this is a general method. I'm not going to go into detail about the General Clauses Act because this lecture is not about the General Clauses Act. Therefore, in that circumstances, my homework for all of you would be, please download General Clauses Act. It's hardly 15 pages. So therefore, it will not consume much size in your memory of your mobile or in your laptop or desktop. So therefore, this is one of the homework which you are supposed to do. Principles of interpretation, there are three important principles which can be considered. One is the literal interpretation. The second is known as a golden. Third is a mischief. These are known as the literal rule of interpretation, golden rule of interpretation, or a mischief rule of interpretation. Let me go to the next slide. Next slide is about the General Clauses Act 1897. Next slide, please. The General Clauses Act is a very effective in the absence of clear definition. Next slide, please. Yes. General Clauses Act is a very effective in absence of a clear definition and a specific enactment, and where there is a conflict between the pre-constitutional law and the post-constitutional law. As I suggested, even the state are having their own General Clauses Act. So therefore, if you are interpreting the pre-constitutional law, let me tell you, this is one of the methods how you can classify the legislations. If it is a pre-constitutional legislation, then of course, the prevailing law, namely the General Clauses Act, should be made applicable while interpreting that law. And if it is a post-independence or post-constitution, then the General Clauses Act along with the state law should be made applicable. The Act gives a clear suggestion for the conflicting provisions and differentiate the legislation according to the commencement and enforcement to avoid uncertainty. States have also enacted. Next, please. Now, this is about the General Clauses Act. But before going into detail, let me share with you what is the meaning of the word statute. Sujit, next slide, please. Now, this lecture of this session is interpretation of statute. We have seen what is the meaning of the word interpretation. We have seen how to interpret object of the interpretation, some basic rules of the interpretation. But what is the meaning of the word statute? The jurist by name Maxwell had said, the statute is the will of the legislature. So in other words, it can be said that it's a formal expression of the will of the legislature. It is also possible to say that the legislature which declares a command or a prohibition of the something. Now we are aware that there are different laws which are prohibiting certain activities. So therefore, this becomes an intention. This becomes a will of the legislature to prohibit something, like prohibition of arms. Take a case of an arms act. Use of an arm at a public place, use of an arm at use of an arm without any license is prohibited. So therefore, that becomes an intention. Not only that, that is an act which says that you cannot use a weapon without a license. So therefore, there is a declaration that what kind of a declaration, that anybody who want to use that weapon under the Arms Act, he will have to obtain a license in respect of that arm. So this is also one of the intention which can be gathered. So these are the statutes. There is an author who has written a very good book and which is in my library, that is N.S. Bindra. He states that statute gives instructions to administrators and the courts, usually securing and maintaining recognized social, political, and economical values. Legislature express national will. Now we are aware that in the preamble, we are aware about the terminology which are used. So justice which has been guaranteed to the citizens of India is not sufficient. That justice will be social, political, and economical justice. So therefore, while defining what is the meaning of the word statute, the author by name Bindra says that these are the instructions to the administrators. We are aware that there are three parts, so three organs. The one organ is a judges, another organ judiciary, another organ is a executive. So therefore, these are the instructions which are given by the legislators. So that is with reference to attaining the justice, social, political, or economical justice. So that's a national will. So Bindra says that it's a national will because it is an act which is enacted by the legislative assembly, legislative council, or the Rajya Sabha or the Lok Sabha. So therefore, it is representing the will of a public at large. Next slide, please. Now let us go to the parts of the different statute. Usually, there is a long title. This is known as a formal portion. In the formal portion, you will find four parts. One, there will be long title, namely, I have been awarded a PhD in the field of PC and PNDT Act. So therefore, what is the long title of PC and PNDT? Preconception and prenatal diagnostic technique, prohibition of sex selection and sex determination Act 1994. So this is the name of that act. So it's a long title, which will be a formal portion. Then there will be a preamble also. In the statute, you will find below the name of that particular statute, there is a preamble, and usually you will find a bracketed portion next to that particular preamble, and there will be some number which is mentioned so that you can come to know what, when that preamble was amended or otherwise, there will be a footnote to that effect. So this is the preamble, which is a formal portion. There will be short title and the commencement and the extent clause. This commencement and the extent clause is relevant because there are large number of legislation which have been introduced, but the date of commencement has been deferred. I will give an example. Advocate Act, there is a provision which says that the advocate can practice all throughout the India. Section 29 recognizes advocate as a class only who is able to practice in the field of law. Section 30 contemplates that anybody can practice in any court of law. This act was not given effect till hardly around 5-7 years back. This has been given effect. So therefore, this is one of such important aspect which can be seen from this formal portion, namely the commencement clause of that particular statute. I'll give another example. We are aware that last year, 2019, the Consumer Protection Act 1986 was replaced by Consumer Protection Act 2019. So it has been gazetted, but the commencement date of that particular act is not yet declared by the government. So therefore, the act is ready, but it is not yet made operational. So therefore, that is a clause which you will find. It is possible that the entire act can be made into commencement at one point of time, or the portion. Like I gave an example of an Advocate Act. The Advocate Act, Section 30 was not given effect for pretty long time, almost 45-50 years. From 1961, the act was not given effect so far as that particular section 30 is concerned. So commencement can be of a full legislation or a part of the legislation. See, equally it says extent. Now we are aware that usually till 2019 there was a usual clause that this will apply to entire India except Jammu and Kashmir. So therefore that was an extent clause which is usually found in the formal portion. Like we, you can find that there are some legislations which are about the northeast states. Qua northeast states, some legislations don't apply because that is known as a tribal belt. So therefore, they are having a special recognition under the constitution itself. So therefore, looking from that angle, this extent clause is also equally relevant, which gives us some better idea. Let us go to the material portion clause. You will find the interpretation or the definition. Usual arrangement of the particular wording of the statute is, which includes that usually section 2 or 3, there will be an interpretation of the definition clause. Then there will be operative sections. Then the scheme of the act, namely operative section means scheme of the act. The important sections will be arranged chronologically. Then there will be a procedural provision. This procedural provision will come after the operative section. This operative section provides for the particular type of the particular type of remedy, particular type of some right, particular creation of some authority, creation of some mechanism, and then thereafter the procedural provisions come. Then the exception comes. This exception will be a last one so far as the material portion is concerned, because this helps us to understand what is exempted from the aforesaid portion. So therefore it comes after the procedural provision or the operative section. Next slide, please. Now, as I said, these are the parts of the statute. So we can go to the types of the statute. There can be a central law. Central statute means the central law which is enacted by the central government, and the state legislatures are known as the state laws. Next slide, please. So these are the general classifications which we are aware that the classification can be whether it's a central law or the state law. Before going to the next aspect, let me point out if there is a conflict between the state law and the central law, which will prevail? That's an important question. So therefore, I'll not answer that particular question, but I will pass on some tips to you. Please go to the Constitution of India after this lecture is over. Please go somewhere near Article 250 and you will come to know what will happen if there is a conflict between the central law and the state law. It is possible. We are aware in the framework of a constitution, there a seventh schedule, there are three lists. Some subjects are there where the central government is empowered to enact. Some subjects are there where state government is supposed to enact. And some subjects are there where there is a concurrent power. So therefore, if while exercising that concurrent power, if there is two legislation on the same field, then what will happen? Who will prevail? There is a conflict. If at all there is a conflict, then what will be a situation? This is one of the homework for all of you. Let us go to the next one. Classification of the statute. It will be based on the time. Namely, as I said, that whether it was a pre-constitutional or the post-constitutional. It can be based on the classification of a statute, can be based on the extent, whether it's a general statute or a local statute. Let me tell you what is that. So far as the state of Maharashtra is concerned, we are aware that Marathwada region was a part of Hyderabad and it was coming under the rule of Nizam till a substantial long time. So therefore, the laws of Hyderabad were made applicable to the that portion which came into India after 1960, which came to Maharashtra after 1961. Therefore, you will find there is a Bombay Tenancy and Agricultural Land Act, which is a general law. But the local law for this Marathwada region, namely 8 districts which are forming part as on today, or now 10 districts, those districts are concerned. The law which is enacted by Hyderabad, so Hyderabad Tenancy and Hyderabad Agriculture Tenancy Law is still made applicable to that portion. Now, the next extent will be based on the special or a personal law. There is a possibility that the law can be special law, namely on that particular topic, or a personal law, namely for a particular class of the citizens. Namely, we are aware that the Hindu law is meant for Hindu. So therefore, it's known as personal law, like Mohammedan law, like Parsi law, like Christian laws. these are known as the personal law. So therefore, whether it is a personal law based on the religion or a special law based on the that particular topic can be ascertained. Then territorial or extraterritorial is one more way how you can classify the statute. So therefore, whether it is applicable to which area, that is also a criteria which can be made applicable. It says now the next is content or a subject matter with which it deals. Based on that, there can be a classification of the statute. Next slide, please. Not only that, now you will find based on the object, the statute can be classified. Now, this is something interesting. And now I'm going to ask you to do a small exercise. This on your screen, you will find with reference to the object, there are different such statute which have been prepared, a list has been prepared. So what is the first is declaratory statute. So therefore, let us prepare a list of five such enactments, which are declaratory. You will have to prepare because in a BLEP, namely basic legal education program, there won't even be spoon feeding. You are not expected to get a complete answer in this. You are supposed to carry some homework for you because this 2-hour lecture is not sufficient to keep you yourself busy. So therefore, I am giving a small homework. You will have to make a list of 5 legislation which are declaratory in nature. It is not difficult. You can find out. Then codification and consolidation. This is another one more aspect. Let us go back to Criminal Procedure Code. Criminal Procedure Code is a codification of the criminal procedure, like civil procedure. It is a codification of the practice on the civil side, as well as what is the word which is used? Consolidation. Consolidation contemplates that there can be a collection of all earlier existing whatever laws which were there, and then codifying that and putting it in the proper manner. You will be aware that there was an old Hindu Shastric law which was codified, and then the codified Hindu law has been divided into 4 or 5 different pieces. So therefore, in 1954-55, we are having a Hindu law which has been divided into like Hindu Marriage Act, Hindu Succession Act, Maintenance Act, Guardianship and Wards Act, several different legislations have been created. So therefore, that is consolidation and codifying. So therefore, let us prepare a list of 5 such acts which are codifying and consolidating. Fiscal. Next is fiscal. I'm sure there is no need to debate on the fiscal. This is about the monetary. So therefore, please prepare a list of those 5 such legislations which are with reference to the fiscal aspect of the statute. Then remedial statute. There are some legislations which can provide you some kind of a remedy. So therefore, which are those statute? You can prepare 5 different lists. The remedy can be provided in the statute itself. So therefore, creation of some kind of a mechanism, like take a case that somebody will start practicing in the cooperative field. So therefore, establishment of the cooperative court will be a remedy which is provided to settle and decide the cooperative disputes. So therefore, that's a remedial enactment. You can prepare other list also. Penal, I'm sure this must be very simple. The penal legislation, you can prepare a list of at least 10 such a legislation where you will find that penal object is also there. Then the enabling is another one more thing. So there are some statute which enables the authorities to go ahead and do something which is required to be, which is a will or intention of the legislation. Here you may find some difficulty. I am not going to give you a spoon feeding. So therefore, you can find out the enabling legislations also. I'm sure you can get at least 5 such piece of legislation. Next slide, please. You can get such 5 piece of legislation based on which you can come to the conclusion that these are the enabling piece of the legislation. The 5th criteria would be duration of the legislation. If a legislation is temporary in nature or a perpetual in nature, that can be classification. The next one is method by which the parliament sets about the attaining the object. There can be a mandatory, imperative or obligatory object. There can be directive and permissive. There is no need to go into the details because these are the words which we are using day in and day out, and at an appropriate time in the present lecture, I'm going to utilize those terminologies once again namely the mandatoriness, namely imperativeness, obligatoriness, as well as directory or permissive. Next slide, please. While practicing in the court of law, you are aware that we are supposed to use or we will be using, or the opponent advocate will be using, some precedent. What is this precedent? And for that particular purpose, I have prepared few slides for the benefit of young lawyers who have enrolled themselves just now. Judicial precedent is a source of law where past decision create the law for judges to refer back to the guidance in the future case. What a fantastic sentence. So therefore, in the present case, which is in front of you, you will apply the principle which is already there, and you will prepare a principle of law which will be guiding force in the future. Now, therefore, let us find out what some jurists have said. So Salmond is one of the jurists. He said precedent is a judicial decision which in itself is a principle. Now, let us understand this. A legal principle, once incorporated in the judgment, then it becomes another principle. So a judicial decision which in itself is a principle. So therefore, once that judicial basic principle is applied in a judgment by the honorable judge, then it becomes a different angle, different context, different texture of that particular principle. So therefore, Salmond says judicial decision in itself is a principle. The underlying principle which forms its authoritative element is often termed as ratio decidendi. This is also one of the keywords which you will have to write down in your notebook, ratio decidendi. The concrete decision is binding between the parties to it, but it is abstract ratio decidendi, which alone has a force of law as regards the world at large. Friends, this requires some kind of a detailed discussion. You must have seen, or you might be witnessing, that there are lawyers who will present different citations before a court of law, either in your favor or opposite you. You will be surprised. The first important exercise which they have not done perhaps is they have not understood what is the law of precedent. What is the ratio decidendi? Ratio decidendi is that particular binding principle which is derived out of that judgment. Take a case that there are around 750 or 660 participants who are attending this session, and I myself, we all are brothers and sisters. And if we go on litigating for our ancestral property, then the judgment which will be delivered, that will bind all of us, namely 661, I myself and 660 participants on that side. But the principle of law which will be derived, which will be incorporated in that judgment, or which will be demonstrated from that judgment, that is known as a ratio decidendi. That will be having a binding effect so far as the world at large, namely in future, the principle of law will be made applicable. Next one, please. The ratio decidendi is a legal principle laid down in a decision which serves as an authority for deciding the cases on the similar facts. So therefore, what is absent? Most of the advocates read a head note of that judgment, and based on that, they submit those judgment without understanding what is a ratio decidendi. Judicial precedent refers to the previously decided judgments of the superior court, such as High Court and Supreme Court, which the judges are bound to follow. Now, these are the general information about precedent. Please go to the next slide. This points out that there will be authoritative precedent, namely binding on the court. And second is persuasive precedent. What is this word persuasive precedent? You won't find this in your statute book, but this is a thing which is required. We are in the state of Maharashtra. The judgment delivered by the Honorable Bombay High Court, and which includes the all benches of a Bombay High Court, though that is binding on all subordinate courts as well as the Bombay High Court itself. But take a case that we are citing a judgment from Karnataka, judgment from Andhra Pradesh, Telangana, or Delhi. Those judgments may not be directly binding, but it is having persuasiveness. So far as authoritative pronouncement is concerned, that is a Supreme Court decision which is binding on all of us, including the judgment delivered by the parent High Court. And persuasiveness means the judgment delivered by the other courts. Next slide. Judgment delivered by the other courts, which are not binding, but that is having a persuasive value. This is also one of the word which you should understand, stare diseases. Doctrine of stare diseases can be found in the constitution itself. There is article 141. Please make a write the homework. Homework is article 141. You are supposed to read that 141 article. That article will tell you that the judgment of the Honorable Supreme Court is made binding on all courts in India. So therefore, this is a doctrine of binding force of the precedent, which is known as the stare decisis. This is based on the English principle, which is derived from the common law. So therefore, I will not go into the detail of the English principles or the common law, because as we are aware that the topic is interpretation of statute. Next slide, please. The topic is interpretation of statute, and therefore, let us, after getting a general knowledge about the statute and the types of the statute classification, let us go to the rules of interpretation. As I said that there are usually two types to look at this, namely primary rule and the secondary rule. Please go to the next slide. So far as the primary rule is concerned, there are five important rules, and I am going to make an appeal, or rather I am going to dictate that please write down all these five rules in your notebook. तुमच्या वहीमध्ये पाचवी शब्द लिहून घ्या, याचा उरलेल्या आयुष्यात नक्की उपयोग होणार आहे. रूल ऑफ लिबरल इंटरप्रिटेशन. हाऊ ए स्टॅट्यूट इज टू बी इंटरप्रिटेड, देर इज वन ऑफ द रूल विच सेज दॅट द लिबरल इंटरप्रिटेशन ऑफ द स्टॅट्यूट. ते जे टर्मिनॉलॉजी जी आहे, ते सेक्शन जो काही आहे, ती वाक्यरचना जी काय आहे, ती प्रोव्हिजन जी काय आहे, दॅट शुड बी इंटरप्रिटेड इन द लिबरल मॅनर. केव्हा कशी काय करायचं, वी विल डू दॅट, वी विल अंडरस्टँड दॅट लिटिल लॅटर. Second is reasonable or purposive interpretation. The legislature is having certain particular object to be achieved. So therefore, qua that, we will have to find out what is that purpose, and then we will have to make a submission so that the honorable judges will understand that particular principle and they can come to a conclusion about the purposive interpretation. A reasonable interpretation is also from that particular category. Third is harmonious interpretation. There may be multiple meaning which are possible. So therefore, the meaning which is having a nexus with the object to be achieved by the legislator is known as a harmonious interpretation. The fourth is a beneficial interpretation. The interpretation which is beneficial to the suppressed class for whose benefit the law is enacted. I'll give an illustration. In the last week, we have seen the Domestic Violence Act. So in the Domestic Violence Act, the aggrieved person, namely the lady who has a shared household, is the person who is at the center of that legislation. So therefore, the beneficial interpretation would be an interpretation in favor of that lady. So therefore, that is known as a beneficial interpretation. Rule of ejus dem generis. This is, I'm sure there, in your law school, whether this question was asked in the question paper or not, I am not aware. But usually, there is a question in the law school about ejus dem generis. But there are no ready-made material with reference to this. So therefore, I'll keep this as it is, these five different things. Let us go to the next slide and let us try to understand what are the different details, rules of interpretation. Now, this is about the liberal or a strict interpretation. I club both the things. Liberal and the strict both are decided, both are covered in one and same slide. After reading a statute book, whatever impression comes in your mind, that becomes a first object of that particular statute. So therefore, if you are interpreting that statute and trying to find out what the legislators wanted to convey, then the first impression that comes to mind should be considered. There is no need to apply any logic or in-depth analysis. That is another characteristics of the rule of liberal interpretation or a strict interpretation, you can say. Read in the ordinary grammatical and natural meaning. Whenever there is no any ambiguity, whenever there is no any double meaning arising out of the particular words or the phrases which are used in the statute book, then their liberal or the strict interpretation, that is possible. It is applicable when the words are clear, when the language is plain. Next slide. When only one meaning is possible, at that point of time, it is possible to say that the liberal or the strict interpretation is possible. Next slide, please. But it can't be applied when the language is ambiguous. As I said, that there is a little here and there, so far as the phrases which are used, then it is possible that the language is ambiguous, and then this liberal or the strict interpretation can't be made applicable. If the meaning is absurd, if it is going to defeat the purpose of the statute, then the rule of liberal or the strict interpretation of the statute can't be made applicable. Next slide, please. This is a general mechanism. This is the first type of the rule. Now let us go to the purposive interpretation. This is somewhat very essential, because you are going to deal with large number of cases arising out of different statute. So therefore, you will have to find out what was the purpose of that statute, what was the intention, what was the object behind that. And then that particular object is required to be considered, and based on that, you can make a submission so that you can convince the honorable judge to deliver a judgment or pass an order in favor of your client. It is also known as logical or functional interpretation. Why? Because we are aware that what is the meaning of that particular word, why this has been used, what is the purpose behind using that particular word. So therefore, this is known as a logical or functional interpretation, as a purposive interpretation. Now, it is very simple to understand what was the intention of the lawmakers, and the sensible person will be able to understand why the particular language is used in that particular manner. So therefore, when it is applicable with the if the literal interpretation is an absurd thing, if the literal interpretation is not possible, if there is ambiguity, then the purposive interpretation comes. As I said that in the initial slide, we have seen the liberal or the strict interpretation, but when it is not possible, then we will have to go to the purposive interpretation and find out what was the object behind that. There can be several examples which can be given about this. Next slide, please. But this can't be applied when the meaning is absurd, when the meaning is anomalous, when there is inconsistency, or when there is an injustice. Next slide, please. So this is about the rule of purposive construction. Now let us go to the next rule, rule of harmonious interpretation. Now this is also a frequently used tool for interpretation. Rule of harmonious interpretation means that legislature never intend to contradict itself by providing two repugnant provisions in the same statute. The legislators do not commit any mistake. That is a presumption which is there. The king can do no wrong is also another principle. So therefore, usually it is presumed that whatever the lawmakers have done, there is no any ambiguity. If there is no ambiguity, then there is no such intention to contradict itself. There is no intention to create a multiple meaning of the same statute. So therefore, the harmonious interpretation means that you will have to harmonize, you will have to balance those particular different phraseology, those different words. The provision of one section of a statute cannot be used to defeat the another provision. It is possible that the word may can be used in the same section at two different places or multiple places, but that word may will have a different meaning. It is possible that word shall, if it is used at multiple places in one particular definition, then there are possibilities that that can be used, that can be given a different meaning also. So this is a required whenever you are implementing the, whenever you are applying the rule of harmonious interpretation, you will have to find out what are where the different meanings, and then the effect should be given to the both one. Next one. This is applicable when there is a contradiction in one section. When there is a contradiction between two sections of the same act, as I said, that there is a possibility that there may be two sections which are contradicting to each other. When there is a two contradiction between two sections of the different act, then also it is possible. For example, Indian Penal Code is a basic law. MoCA is a special law. So therefore, when MoCA and the Indian Penal Code are contradicting with each other, then the harmonious interpretation rule will come into play. Like, you are aware that a order for cancellation of bail can be challenged before the Honorable High Court if the bail has been cancelled under Indian Penal Code. But so far as MoCA Act is concerned, please go to Section 21. Section 21, Subsection 4, Subsection 5 may be seen. That is a burden which is created by the statute. And there are some classifications also. There are preconditions which are laid down. So therefore, harmonious interpretation requires that there are two different acts. But a provision to challenge the cancellation of bail, there are some contradictory provisions. So therefore, there is a need for the harmonious construction. Please go to the next slide. You can come across n number of such examples which will be useful for your day-to-day practices. Because in the court of law, these are the examples which are going to give you a large number of winning briefs. Because if you apply this method of interpretation of statute, then I'm sure you will be getting much more clientage and your success rate or the success percentage will increase. Now let us go to the rule of beneficial construction. Now there is a tendency of relaxation of strictly liberal principles of interpretation where usual meaning of the word falls short of the object of the legislature. It involves extension of the letter so that when the judges are faced with choice between two meanings, which is a provision capable of, they will often choose the wider one, which carries the object of the statute more fully. It is not that difficult to understand because it says that the beneficial construction of a statute or a provision, that is not that difficult because the judges, if they are convinced that there are two meanings or more than one meaning is possible, then in that particular circumstances, they will have to choose one which is beneficial to the person to whom the protection is required to be given. I'll give an illustration. There are different labor welfare legislation. While interpreting those labor legislation, the rule of beneficial construction is made applicable. There is a Workman's Compensation Act. In the Workman's Compensation Act, the law is interpreted to protect the person, namely the workman. So therefore, the honorable judges will lean down in favor of the workman while deciding the cases. Take a case of Motor Vehicle Act. So the case is filed before the Motor Accident Case Tribunal, MACP. Then in that MACP, you will be required to make a submission that a beneficial construction is required because the object of this legislation is to protect the victim of that motor accident or the legal heirs and the representative of the deceased person who was protected or who is a aggrieved person. This can be this beneficial rule of construction is applicable when the liberal interpretation fails. When the words are ambiguous, then the beneficial construction is possible. Next one, this rule of beneficial construction is intended to suppress the mischief. Now, this is something irrelevant. The legislators makes the law with a clear intention to suppress some mischief. They know that people are going to break the law. People are trying to commit some offense. So that is that mischief. I'll give a latest example why large number of or thousands of cases are registered in the state of Maharashtra under Section 188 of Indian Penal Code. 188 contemplates that the person is not following the directions issued by the public servant or the government. Government has issued a direction about the lockdown. Government has issued the direction about the 144 CRPC. So therefore, if it is not followed, then automatically there is a possibility of commission of some mischief. So therefore, if there is a mischief, then the beneficial construction rule will have to be made applicable. This rule is for advancing the remedy which is provided under the statute. But if a liberal interpretation is possible, if the language is not ambiguous, only one meaning is possible, then the beneficial construction is not required to be invoked. Next slide. If the meaning is absurd, then the beneficial construction will be applicable. But the next slide, please. But unless and until these criteria are made applicable, I'm afraid it won't be a correct way to look at the act. Rule of ejus dem generis. Please note down. Ejus dem generis. Please write down. I'm sure there would have been a short note in your law school on this topic. So the general words are to be construed with reference to the specific words that precede them. What is this? A simple example. I ask my daughter and a son to go in the market and purchase mango, banana, guava, watermelon, and such other things. This is a direction. So direction is given to whom? To my daughter and the son. What is the direction? To purchase mango, banana, guava, watermelon, and such other things. Now the rule of ejusdem generis comes into play. That means such other things means that is in connection with what is mentioned earlier, namely all those guava, banana, watermelon, and mango. So therefore, whatever they want to purchase is should have nexus with the same thing which is earlier mentioned. So therefore, that means they can purchase a fruit. So therefore, that is a rule of ejusdem generis. Tomorrow, our daughter and our son, if they go and purchase some kind of a dress, then I am afraid that can't be called as a direction or a order. So therefore, this is known as a rule of ejusdem generis. This is a simplest possible example which I give. There must be, when it can be applied, there must be enumeration of the certain words. The specific word must constitute a class or a category. General words must follow a specific word. So what is the general word? And such other things, that's a general. What is the specific word? I gave example of four different fruits. So therefore, that classification, that class is, the class of a fruit is there. So therefore, that is the class in respect of which specific words are there and general words are with reference to such other things. When it is not applicable, if any of the condition is not followed, then the rule of ejusdem generis cannot be made applicable. If the specific word follows general words, again, reverse direction, then again, this can't be made applicable. So therefore, this is a rule of ejusdem generis. Please keep this in mind because there may be some cases where rule of ejusdem generis can be made applicable. Because in the statute book also, you will find the phraseology, such other things is found in the different statute book. Like take a case that a registrar is given certain power. Registrar is given certain power to do 1, 2, 3, 4 things and such other things. Now in that such other thing, he can't do something which is beyond the earlier 3, 4 powers which are given to him. So whatever is not permissible, not in connection with the earlier 4 specific words, you can't do the general things. So therefore, this is a rule of ejusdem generis. And if that registrar act beyond the authority, then it is known as ultra vires. Then that particular action can be struck down. Please go to the next one. Next slide is secondary rules of interpretation, which we have seen about primary rule. Now, please write down this slide also. And my appeal to all friends would be, please note down these 6 different words. The first is nociter associis. Then conjunctive or disjunctive words, non-obstant clause, mandatory and directive provisions, reading down provision. Reading down will require some kind of a discussion because I'm sure in your law school also this must not have been discussed with you. And the presumption as to constitutionality is the another thing. Now let us go to the next slide, which will be the first slide about the nociter. The meaning of the word is to be derived from its associate word. It's a very simple thing. This is a Greek, this is a Latin phrase. Latin phrase which says that the meaning of the word will have to be derived from the words which are associated with. To be very frank, in Marathi we say that from the company the person is known. To manus tya manasacha bhutalcha je kai tyachi dost mandali ahe, mitra mandali ahe, tyachyavarun olakhla jato. So therefore, this is again a simple meaning or that the meaning of the word can be derived from its associate word. Nociter's principle, this principle is found used in different judgments also. There is no need to go into the detail. The words in a statute are construed with reference to the words found in immediate connection with them. So therefore, tyacha shezari asnara, immediate connection madhe asnara, ek don paul pathivaga asnara, ek don word alikade asnara, in the context of that, the meaning of that word will have to be derived at. So therefore, again, the same principle which I said that from the company of the words, the meaning of that word can be derived. If two or more words which are capable of analogous meaning are grouped together, they should be understood in the cognate sense. That is, they should take a color from each other and are given a similar or a related meaning. So therefore, again, we are aware, next slide, we are Maharashtrian, Marathi person. So dhavlaya shezari pavlaya banla, so gun nahi lagla, vaan matra lagla. So this kind of a phraseology, we are aware. So therefore, if the word is required to be considered, then it should be from the associate words, the meaning of that particular word will have to be understood. The second is conjunctive or disjunctive words. This is something relative, which is useful for day-to-day practice also. And my appeal to all young friends who are on that side, please make a note of this. And is a conjunctive or is a disjunctive. But this, what are the meaning of this? Use of conjunctive and or one for or other is permissible where liberal interpretation would be the intention of a legislature. I'll explain what is this. In a statute book, there is a provision which says that so-and-so and so-and-so, this is the clear meaning. So that means that there are two categories which are there. The word and combines both things. So therefore, as soon as the word and is there, both things are brought together. If the word or is there, then it is disjunctive. So therefore, two categories are created. But the interpretation of statute tells us that and can also be read as or. And in addition to this, or can also be read as and. Vice versa, it is possible. When it is permissible? It is permissible when the liberal interpretation rule tells you, liberal interpretation rules permits you, and there is an intention of the legislature, then it is possible. So therefore, while making a submission, you can develop your innovative submission and say that, sir, though the legislators have used the word and, in my respectful submission, please use a liberal interpretation mechanism and instead of and, read it as or. Or vice versa, you can make that submission. So this is also a one of the such method which can be used, because we are supposed to develop our own submission. That genuinity or that kind of a creativity is possible if you try to interpret that word in a different manner and use different such principles which are there. The next slide, please. There is a non-obstant clause which is seen in various legislation. It says that notwithstanding anything contained in any other law. That means the provision of that particular section is to be read dehors the other statute or the provisions made in that statute. That is the meaning of the word notwithstanding. So whatever may be the provision which are there in that statute or other statute, forget about that. And qua this particular section, qua this particular group of section, qua this particular chapter, qua this particular section act, you can create a special category. That special category is possible. I'll give an illustration. A statute where this notwithstanding words are used, like the special statutes are made. Now, special statute, like I can say, negotiable instrument, where you will find that there is a special creation of a presumption. The presumption is a rebuttable. So therefore, you can go to that particular aspect. Take a case that there is a PC and PNDT Act in which I have been awarded a PhD. So therefore, even that topic you will find, irrespective of the Code of Criminal Procedure Code, these offenses are required to be dealt with in a particular manner. Like you will find Prevention of Food Adulteration Act. That's a special statute where you will find, notwithstanding in anything contained in that regular code, you will find that separate provision is made. So there are the different ways how the legislators have conveyed their meaning, their intention. Their intention is to create a separate clause. The proper way to construct a non-obstant clause is first to ascertain the meaning of the enacted part on a fair construction of its word. So find out what is a general meaning, what is a usual meaning of that. Keyword used in the non-obstant clause, if notwithstanding, which serves the purpose restricting or controlling, circumscribing the provisions which are negative. So therefore, there is a provision in the negative manner saying that if the special class is to be created, then notwithstanding anything, there will be a separate group which is created in that created by the legislator. Please go to the next slide. You are aware that I kept certain words in a deep freezer by saying that we will deal with this a little later. Now this is that word, mandatory and directory provisions. There are different legislations which will be mandatory in nature or a directory in nature. Now there will be a debate on this, whether the act is mandatory in nature or directory. I'll give an example. Those who have studied civil procedure code, setting aside ex parte, the affidavit of evidence to be filed within a particular period, that is a provision. After the Malimut committee recommendation which were made in 2002, the law was amended and affidavit of evidence is required to be filed, that provision is made. Now the question came whether there is a provision to expand the scope and grant an adjournment or enlarge the time period which is provided. The matter went up to the Honorable Supreme Court. And then in the Salem Bar Association case, this issue was also considered, which says that whether it is mandatory or directory. If we want to come to the conclusion whether it is mandatory, then there would have been a consequences of non-following that particular thing. In other words, in the legislature, if the legislators wanted to say that this particular act is or this particular provision is mandatory, then they will provide the consequential penalty, consequential default action, consequential some other things which are possible and permissible within that statute. So therefore, this is provided. If this is provided, then you can come to the conclusion that there is a mandatory provision. Take a case that now Consumer Protection Act. In the Consumer Protection Act, you will find for filing of the written version, there is a time-bound program which is given. That time-bound program is not having a consequential penalty or consequential thing. So therefore, an argument was advanced that no, this is not mandatory. This is directory. As far as possible, this schedule will have to be added. Let us go to the Commercial Codes Act. Now the new act which has been introduced in 2016, the amendments were made in 2018. And large number of litigations are going to come on this act. Under this act, Commercial Codes Act. Commercial Code Act contemplate that even no WS order can't be passed after 120 days. So 120 days is the time which is provided. So thereafter, you can't condone the delay and extend the time. So therefore, if you are dealing with a Commercial Codes Act, then within that stipulated period, you will have to file your written version. Take a case about the Arbitration and Conciliation Act. Arbitration and Conciliation Act contemplates that once the award is there, Section 34 contemplates that it can be challenged before the Honorable High Court. And for that particular purpose, 90 days plus extended 30 days. So therefore, in all, 120 days are provided under the statute. If you file it on 121st day, that can be accepted. There is no provision. So therefore, it is mandatory. Let us go to the next topic in the same slide. Whether it is directory and discretionary provision. Whether it is directory, we have seen that if there are no consequences, whether there is a discretion. If usually, there are provisions which are directory in nature, there is an element of discretion which is available. So therefore, this go hand in hand. Whenever there is a directory provisions which are made, then the discretionary powers are given. Now, consequences of non-compliances are provided. Then there will be a particular language which will be used in those kind of sections where a mandatoriness is shown or a particular message is required to be conveyed. Like this, shall, must, may, should. But as I said about and or, here also, there is one more innovative argument which is possible. What is that? If there is a may, which is word, which is used, may contemplates that there is a discretion. Then if you make a submission that, sir, may should be read as a shall, that is also possible. But that will depend on the frame of that statute. That will depend on the wordings which are used in that statute. That is depend on the object which is to be performed. And you will have to apply a particular rule of interpretation in support of your submission. Then it is possible that there can be a submission that may, namely directory, should be used as shall. Otherwise, you will have to make a submission that, sir, if May is not read as a shall, then there is an apprehension that there will be a injustice. There will be a failure of the object which is sought to be achieved by the legislator. These are the different ways how you can develop your innovative argument. The litigant is not going to tell you. Litigant is going to come with a bundle of facts. Those facts, once placed before you, you will have to find out the law which is applicable. Then the section, then the read that section, and then try to mold that section so as to make it suitable to your own independent submission, which will be helpful to your client. So therefore, this is a one more innovative way, that even the other way, that even if the wording is used as a shall, please read it as a may. It is possible. There are n number of judgments on that. So therefore, this is another homework. When may can be used as shall, or shall can be used as may. And this is a homework which you are supposed to do. So this BLEP is going to give you ample homework, which will keep yourself free, which will keep yourself busy throughout the day. So I'm sure you must have noted down the homework. Please go to the next slide. The homework was about when shall can be used as may and may can be used as shall. Now this is reading down provision. A few minutes back I said that this is also a topic which is usually not discussed. This is a one more comparatively a younger method of interpretation. This says that if there is some kind of a mischief which is likely to happen, then the judges can be asked to read down those provisions of the law so that the mischief can be controlled and the object of that act can be achieved. Strike down the legislation which is ultra vires of the constitution, but maintain the balance one, that is known as the reading down. It is possible that in the one statute you can find that there are certain phraseologies which are ultra vires, but equally some things are there which are really good. So qua that, you can say that maintain the good one and strike down the whatever which is ultra vires. Let us go back to the principles of appreciation of evidence. In the appreciation of evidence also, we are aware that the witness in the box says so many things, but we are required to find out what is relevant, what is useful, and use that in support of the our case, which are or for achieving our object for which the litigant has come to us. So this is one of the way how this can be done. So reading down the provision is permissible, but this is not used frequently, because this is permissible by the constitutional courts, namely at the High Court or the Supreme Court level. So therefore, at the district level or a tehsil level, reading down the provision is not possible. Please go to the next slide. But as I said, that this is not used regularly, but I should give some idea about the reading down provision principle. Presumption about the constitutionality. I'm sure there won't be any difficulty. Statute is valid and intra vires to the constitution. There is a presumption. Legislator has not transgressed his legislative ambit, and statute is within his legislative competence. Here there is something which is required to be pointed out. We are aware that, as I said, 7th schedule, 3 list. So therefore, which power is invoked by the legislators while enacting the law, that becomes useful. If the power which is exercised by the legislators is beyond the list which is provided in the constitution, then it is beyond the legislative competence. So therefore, whether state government was competent enough to frame the law on the topic which falls in the central list, of course, if they do so, then it can be said that they are not competent to pass that particular law. Now, it also says that, however, not of indefinite application, unnatural and forced meaning cannot be put up upon words to save the statutory provision. So therefore, this is about the presumption. Please go to the next slide. The presumption of the constitutionality is always there. Now, let us go to the important aspect about the aid which we can get for interpretation. Now there are two classifications. One is internal air, namely in the statute itself, and the another is the external air. I'm going to request you that please note down all these things, because this is going to help you in the rest of the life as a student of law while making a submission. The first is, so far as internal aid is concerned, title, preamble. We are aware about the title, we have seen preamble, we have seen heading of the title or a chapter, definition, marginal note, proviso, explanation, illustration, schedule. These are the internal aids which you can find in the statute itself. What are the external aid of interpretation? Historical settings. Two, consolidating statutes and previous laws. So what was the earlier provision that can also be utilized? Usages, what was the practice, usage, custom, reference to the other act, because there are several such act which makes a reference to the other act, like a transfer of property, like an Indian Penal Code, like a Criminal Procedure Code, like Limitation Act. So these are the act which are referred in the different statute. So by making a reference to that particular thing, there is external aid. Dictionary can be external aid. Judicial decisions can be external aid. Changes in the technology can also be an external aid. Next slide, please. Now let us try to consider in detail. For those who could not write down, again, I have provided one more slide. What are the internal aids? So those who are interested, they may write down. Let us go to the next slide. Title. The short title, I have given an example, IPC. Long title, Indian Penal Code. So short title is an IPC, long title is an Indian Penal Code. So far as long title is concerned, it describes the act. It is not settled that long title of an act is a part of the act. We can therefore refer it to the ascertain the object, scope, and the purpose of the act. So therefore now, you must be having at least 5-10 different Bayer Act at your home. So therefore, after this session is over, please go to any of such Bayer Act and find out the long title and the short title. You will come to know that there are two different things, like a short title and then there is a long title. BTAL Act, MLRC. What is that MLRC? Maharashtra Land Revenue Code 1966. These are the certain act. Then transfer of property, TP, Specific Relief Act, SRA. These are the different enactments which are there, which are having their short title. There is a long title also, which I pointed out. Please go to the next slide. As I said that thereafter, we come to the preamble. Preamble expresses the scope, object, and the purpose of the act more comprehensively than long title. Long title gives a general idea, but preamble gives us a specific idea. There are some legislation where preamble is very short. But now the new generation legislations, you will find the preambles are lengthy preambles. Those preambles are going to convey different meaning. Now one more thought when you are in the blip. In the blip, I am going to ask you to do one more exercise. Usually, there is a one legislation covering one particular topic. There may be a declaratory legislation. There may be a prohibitory legislation. There may be a remedial legislation. But a composition of different such object and then making a one legislation. Have you come across? How many such computations are permissible, possible and seen? Have you seen that? Please consider this. I'll give an illustration. A prohibitory object and regulatory object may go together. In addition to this, you can come to know that there can be a declaratory object along with the remedial object. This is also possible. You can also come to know that there are different permutation or combination which are possible. We have seen almost 6-7 different objects are there. So those objects, if utilized in a different permutation combination manner, then there can be a different set of legislation. This is one more thought which you should take home. This is that take back from this session. This session is going to tell you that what is required to be done at home. So you can do an exercise and find out which different topics, which different such methods are possible, which different object can be achieved by applying the different mechanism. So therefore, the preamble will be able to tell us what is that object. So preamble tells us there may be object of prohibition, there may be object of prevention, there may be object of regulation, there may be object of declaration, there may be object of remedy, there may be object, some other objects are there. So while reading the preamble of that act, you can come to know that what is the meaning, why the enactment is made. And of course, on that touchstone, if you try to apply that touchstone to each and every provision, you will come to know why the enactment is made. So let us come back to the slide. It says preamble can legitimately use for interpretation. There is no difficulty. The preamble can be used to find out what is the meaning of the, what is the intention of the legislator. So therefore, it can be used for interpretation. It shows primary intention of the lawmaker. It cannot override the plain provisions of the Act. Let us keep this in mind. The preamble cannot override the plain meaning of the statute. Please go to the next slide. This will show you that in our Constitution of India, you must have come across the preamble. This is that preamble, and I can very proudly share with you, in my office in Fort area in Mumbai, there is a big frame of this preamble which is prepared and it is provided for guidance to all. It is translated into Marathi because Marathi is the official language of the state of Maharashtra. So therefore, I have translated it in Marathi and it is prepared and displayed in my office. You can also prepare this. There such things are available. But the test which I was sharing is this, that though the preamble provides everything, but preamble cannot override the provisions of the Act. Likewise, the preamble of the Constitution cannot override the provisions which are made in the Constitution itself. Next slide. So on the same line, we can say that the preamble of the Act cannot control or cannot regulate the provisions of the statute, but it is used as a aid for interpretation. Heading and title of that chapter. Number of sections are covering a particular subject and grouped together in the form of a chapter. Like I take a case of a constitution. In the constitution, there are different chapters. So there are different parts. So parts and chapter are made, and that is a clubbing of the particular provision. Like Constitution of India, fundamental right comes in part 3. FD comes in part 5. DPSP comes in part 3, part 4. So these are the things which are provided. So that's a groupism of a particular section. So therefore, that section or that group of section is having some heading or that is having some title. So therefore, this is also a aid which is available. Each chapter is given a heading which represents the subject matter dealt within that chapter. So therefore, while interpreting a provision of that particular section, we'll have to go back to that heading, which will tell us as to how it is required to be done. There are multiple views on heading. One of the view is that heading is treated as a key to interpretation of a section covered by it. And the other view considers that heading may be referred only when enacting words are ambiguous. Now, I must tell you one more example in which reported judgment is there. Persons with Disability Act was there. The disabled persons were protected by virtue of that act. There is a 1995 enactment which has been now repealed. In that 1995 enactment, section 47 was there. Section 47 contemplates that the person cannot be reduced in the rank or removed from the services if the person has attained disability in the course of the employment. A gentleman came to us saying that he sustained an accident during the course of the employment and his employer has terminated him. So therefore, he said that my employer is a private employer. So therefore, what is to be done? We made an attempt to go to the High Court and seek an order. Though the Act is applicable to the government establishments only, so we tried to take a benefit of the heading of that particular section that says no discrimination in the employment. So wording is no discrimination in the employment. So therefore, based on that, the submission was advanced to say that there is a possibility to include the private employer also in this section. Division bench of Justice Hemant Gokhale and Roshan Dalvi gave us interim relief, protected the services for a time being. But later on, the matter came up before the division bench of Justice Ribello and some other junior judge. We lost in that. Matter was carried to the Supreme Court. Supreme Court also held against us, saying that if the wording is ambiguous, then it is possible that the heading can be referred. The terminologies which were used in that section says that in the government establishment, this can be done usually. So therefore, the court was of the view that the submission which was advanced was not correct. Next slide, please. Now you will find definition is also covered. Now definition gives us interpretation or a way how a wording is, how that particular act is required to be interpreted. The object of such definition is to avoid repetition. Now here in the definition, the keywords are, while providing a definition, the wording is means and includes. Now this is something important. What does it say? It says that the while preparing a definition, the legislators may come with the particular manner in which it is said that so and so means A, B, C, P, Q, R. What is the meaning of that? Sometimes the legislator says that so and so includes A, B, C. So what is the meaning of that? So please write down a homework for all of you. What is the word if it is used as a means in the definition? And if it is said that it includes, then how this makes a lot of difference. Now this is the thing which is required to be considered. Now you will find if there is a word which is used as include in the definition, then that definition becomes very, very exhaustive, very inclusive definition. So therefore it is possible to add different other things in that definition. But when it is used that the legislators are using the word means in the definition, then that means they are restricting to those aspects. Let us go back to that example which I gave. Definition word, I said that includes A, B, C, P, Q, R. But in the word means, I said A, B, C only. So therefore, when the legislators were wise enough to exclude P, Q, R, that means there was a specific object behind that. The object was to include A, B, C. Therefore, they used the wording of means. I'll give an example. Unfair trade practice means P, Q, R. Or unfair labor practice. In the labor legislation, there is a separate legislation for us. MRTU and Pulp Act. Monopolistic Restricted Trade Practice Act is there. Then there are several such legislation. So therefore, whenever the word includes is used in the definition, it expands the scope and covers different things which are not mentioned therein also. But when the wording is means, then of course, this is creating a small group which is sought to be introduced by virtue of that. General Clauses Act will be useful because Section 3 of that Act provides a definition of different provisions. So therefore, without fail, please go to the General Clauses Act. Next slide, please. Now it says about the marginal notes. Marginal notes are in the statute books on the margin. Jala apan Marathi madhe samas manto. If there is a statute which is a statute book, techamadhe right hand side like a left hand side, you will find marginal notes. That marginal notes are the captions which are found printed at the side of the section. These are the notes or the captions which purport to summarize the effect of the section are called as marginal notes. Ata prashna nirman zala. Now the question is whether marginal note can control the meaning of that particular statute. If the statute or words are ambiguous, then the marginal notes can be utilized for the purpose of interpretation. This is the internal aid because it is there in the statute book. So therefore, that is used, but again the same which is applicable to the head note. Marginal notes cannot limit or restrict the meaning of the clear words used in the statute or in that section. I'm sure there won't be any difficulty in understanding this. Let us go to the next one. Next is proviso. Next slide speaks about the proviso. Legislative device, this is a legislative device which carved out an exception to the main provision. Namely, the legislators wanted to say a particular concept is introduced. In that concept, if they want to carve out some kind of exception, then that is possible. So therefore, they are creating a special category of a person and showing it as a proviso. Now there is a possibility, one more interesting thing. There can be proviso to proviso. How can that be done? Now, therefore, a homework for all of us. The homework would be whether there can be proviso to proviso. And if yes, then what is the meaning of that? I'm not going to include that in my sharing with you because I believe in giving some homework to all BLEP participants. So therefore, please write down which are sections or act where proviso to proviso is provided. We have seen what is the meaning of the word proviso. Proviso means a carving out some exception creation of a separate group, protecting that particular group. Now, what are the four purposes of a creation of a proviso? That is also mentioned. Qualify or accept certain provisions from the main enactment. Two, entirely change the very concept of entitlement of an enactment by inserting certain mandatory condition. Three, it assumes tenor or color of a substantive enactment. Next one, please. Now, these are the four characteristics of the proviso. Proviso can create a separate class, and that can be a separate statute for itself. And the fourth one may be used merely to act as an optional addenda to the enactment with the sole object of explaining the real intent of the provision. It is that simple. So therefore, these are the four different characters of the proviso which we have seen. Please go to the next slide. There can be explanation. Now, you are aware that in the Indian Contract Act, there are several exceptions, several explanations are also provided. Likewise, in the Indian Penal Code, there are explanations which are provided. If there is some concept which is sought to be introduced, then for better understanding and for guiding the executives and the honorable judges, the explanations are provided. So the slide says, object of the explanation to the statutory provision is to explain the meaning of the meaning and intent of the act, to clarify the obscurity or the vagueness, provide additional support to the dominant object of the act in order to make it more meaningful and purposeful. It is that simple. So therefore, next slide, there are few more things about the explanation. So the explanation helps us in giving a better knowledge, better idea, better clarity, to help or assist the court in interpreting the true purpose and intent of the enactment in order to suppress the mischief and advance the object of that. This was held in Swamiso Sundaram Pillai, etc. There is no necessity to go to all those judgments. You must have seen almost 50 slides are already over, but I have not cited any judgment. Why? Because it's a blip. In a CLEP, that is Continuous Legal Education Program, we can mainly highlight on different judgments. But since you are a young lawyer whose age is hardly few months, so therefore, for all of you, I have prevented myself from using or bombarding all of you from with the help of different citations, but that can be done at a later point of time. Please go to the next slide. So the explanation can be used as an internal aid. There can be illustrations in the Contract Act, in the specific Special Contract Act, Sale of Goods Act, in the Transport of Property Act, you will find illustrations are given. Illustrations are appended to the section form from part of a statute, and although forming no part of the enactment, sections are of a relevance and value in the construction of the text of the session. This is helpful to find out the real meaning of the principle which is mentioned therein, but it does not limit the generality of the section for which it is prepared. Next one. The next slide would be about the schedule. The schedules are appended to the statute. Like we have seen in the first lecture of a civil procedure code that there are schedules which are annexed to the civil procedure code. There are some forms also which are provided in the civil procedure code. Likewise, in the Constitution of India, you will find there are different schedules which are there. So schedule appended to a statute form a part of the statute and may be used in construing the provisions of the body of the act. The main purpose for which the schedules may be used include the following. One, for incorporating the table of fees, duties and taxes. In a taxing statute, you will come to know that there are different schedules. Like take a case of an income tax act. There are schedules. Even if you go to the excise, custom, you will find schedules are there. Table of fees. Now here also you will find the schedule are provided. Duties, the whatever entertainment duty, about that there will be a schedule. If you go to Maharashtra Land Revenue Code, there will be a schedule pointing out who is an appellate authority also. Next is for prescribing forms of application, notice, license, registers of the record. So therefore that provides a different form. So you have seen that in the Civil Procedure Code, there are different such forms which are available, which are appended. Even in the Consumer Protection Act, there is a form which is provided, that is in the schedule. For describing in detail this, a scheme for the working of for an institution or a body, and then says that for incorporating the transitory provision. So these are the provisions which are next slide. So these are the characters of the different schedules. Now let us go to the operation of a statute. Here something which is important. The date of commencement of the act, section 3 subsection 13 contemplates the date on which the date will be commenced. The date of commencement, I have made a detailed submission about this by pointing out section 30 of the Advocate Act. Now the question comes about the prospectivity or the retrospectivity of that particular act. Now here something is required to be discussed. Usually those act which are creating a right, those act will have a prospective effect. So far as the retrospective effect is concerned, those act which provides a remedy, those acts will have a retrospective effect. But there is again no straitjacket formula or no hard and fast rule. It says that if there is a otherwise provided that it is possible, then it is a prospective or the retrospective will have to be determined, though it is a law which is creating a right or law which is creating a remedy or providing a procedure. Now there is a one more important word which I am keeping as a homework for all of you. That is that fourth word on your screen, that is retroactive. Please write down this. And there is something interesting which perhaps in the next session somebody will try to cover. This retroactiveness of the legislation is an important new concept which has been introduced very recently. So therefore, very recently in the sense, comparatively recently. So therefore, prospective we have seen from the date it will have an application. Retrospective means the date of that particular commencement, but have application in the prospective, in the retrospective manner, it will go back to that date. But what is the meaning of the word retroactive? Now, this is a homework for all of you. Please go to the next slide. Now, let us go to the external aids. Now, the external aids, as I said, that internal aids are available in the statute itself. So therefore, external aid, that again, those who want to write down, the list is in front of you. Historical setting, consolidating statutes and previous laws, usage, reference to the other act, dictionaries, judicial decision, changes in the technology. Please go to the next one. That is historical settings, oblique legislative history. Legislative history and the social history of the legislation are equally important to understand why the law was enacted. This is the external aid. For example, in the state of Maharashtra, why the Hindu Succession Act was amended in the year 1994, more particularly 22nd of June 1994. What was the prevailing social situation at that point of time? What was the political situation at that point of time? What was the economical situation at that point of time? And these are the part of the social, these are the part of the social history about that particular legislation. Legislative history in the sense that when the act was enacted from time to time, let us go back to the Dowry Act. You will find Dowry Act of 1961, but it was found that it is not having enough mechanism in it. So therefore it was amended from time to time. Then in 1984, it was again amended so that certain persons were protected. So there are certain types of the transactions were protected from the dowry. So therefore, this gives us a idea what was the intention behind that particular amendment or why that enactment was made. The parliamentary debate or the reports of the law commission is also external aid. This is not an internal. Usually, I'll say that the old rule was that the parliamentary debates and the reports of the law commission cannot be used to interpret the statute. But the Honorable Supreme Court from last almost around 10-15 years have started relying on the parliamentary debates as well as the reports of the law commission to find out the actual meaning of the legislators. So far as English law is concerned, on the basis of which the interpretation of statute is based, there you will find that the debates in the parliament or the law commission reports are treated as an external aid. But in India, now by virtue of the Supreme Court judgment, the parliamentary debates and report of the law commission are included and therefore they can be used. Now, It includes the parliamentary history, historical facts, report of the expert committee, which is also covered in this. Please go to the next slide. Now it says that consolidated statutes and the previous laws. If there is a consolidation of the two statutes, then we will have to consider the previous law also. For example, the Hindu law is a codification of the Shastric law. So therefore, Shastric law, which was there, plus in prior to Hindu law, almost around 70 years, there were different enactments which were made, Hindu Widows Remarriage Act, like Gain of Learning Science Act 1927. So these acts were consolidated, and based on that, a new act was enacted, namely a Hindu law. So therefore, consolidation of the statute and the previous law, this will have to be considered. For example, GST. The GST is a new law, which is a consolidation of sales tax and other service tax also. Now, Arbitration and Conciliation Act 1996, which provides consolidation of the Foreign Award Act 1961 and the Arbitration Act 1937. So it's a consolidation. As I said, Hindu, where Shastric law was there, Smriti and Shruti were considered as a source of law in the Hindu law. That is again covered in the consolidated law. So this is one of the external aid. So therefore, next slide. So we can go back to the basic rule, these are the external aid, and we can use the previous laws for the purpose of finding the meaning of the consolidated statute. Usage. Now we are aware that the usage customs are also a source of law. So therefore, in the Hindu law, Saptapadi is known as a traditional way of performing a marriage. So therefore, this is a usage, which is a ritual, which is a custom, which is followed in our society. So therefore, that usage is now having a force of law, because it is covered as the essentials of valid Hindu marriage. Like in a Muslim, the Muslim Woman Protection of Right on Divorce Act 1986 was based on the usage in the Muslim law. So therefore, in the Shabano case, when this Shabano case, such issue came up before the Honorable Supreme Court. Next slide, please. In the Shabano case, that was considered by the Honorable Supreme Court, and the new law was enacted. So these are the usage and traditions which were there. Now, even the latest one is with reference to the triple talaq, which is also covered in this. That was one of the usage which was happening. That was a practice which was followed. So therefore, uttering a talaq word on three occasions in one single sitting is now deprecated by virtue of the Honorable Supreme Court. Now, the reference to the other act, that is also possible. Now, I'll give an example. Consumer Protection Act 1986 and the Competition Act 2002, we are having the same intention to protect the consumer. So therefore, while interpreting the provisions of Consumer Protection Act, you can go back to the Competition Act 2002, and you can rely on the Competition Commission judgment. Now, there was one more act, Monopolistic Restrictive Trade Practice Act, MRTP. Now, not regional town planning, MRTP. And that there was a MRTPC, which was prior to Competition Commission Act. So MRTPC judgment were also useful for protecting the consumer, for protecting the rights of the consumer. So therefore, this was one of the way to understand the different other enactment and understand the provisions of that act. It says that it may also include reference to the repealed or deleted part of that. So therefore, if earlier act is deleted, you can also refer to that. Sometimes earlier acts are explained by the latter act. So therefore, it is also possible. Doctrine of pari materia is also an important principle. I'll give an example. We are aware, write down the judgment, Javed Khan. There is a judgment of Javed Khan. Please note down. We are aware that in the village panchayat election, amendment was made in the Bombay Village Panchayat Act. Now it is a Maharashtra Village Panchayat Act. That amendment says that if you are having more than two children, then you are debarred from contesting the election. Validity of that was challenged before the different high courts matters were clubbed together, and the Supreme Court delivered a judgment in that Javed Khan case, in which the provision of Haryana was pari materia with the provision of India, provision of Maharashtra. So Bombay Village Panchayat Act, same concept. And in Haryana, same concept. So therefore, that judgment is applicable to Bombay Village Panchayat Act also. So therefore, this is an external aid, that if the concept is parimateria, is if the principle is parimateria, if the terminology is parimateria, then doctrine of parimateria can be made applicable. That means the parimateria means in another statute, the similar provision is there, similar principle is there, similar concept is there, similar right is there. Then you can try to enforce that particular thing in the present statute. Next one, there can be a dictionaries which can be used. Of course, dictionaries can also have a external aid, but the dictionaries which are useful is not that which is available on online, but a legal dictionary will have to be used. Please go to the next one, judicial decisions. The judicial decisions which are available, that can also be a external aid to decide the real interpretation, real meaning of that word. So therefore, reference to the Indian decision is possible. Reference to the foreign decision is also possible. But the country is following the same system of jurisprudence as in our courts, and foreign decisions have same application. Namely, we are a Commonwealth country. So therefore, the Commonwealth country judgments, or the judgment delivered by the judges from the Commonwealth, that is possible. That can be used in India. Likewise, prior to independence, Government of India Act 1935 created Federal Court. So therefore, that Federal Court will be of Federal Court judgments will be useful. Then prior to independence, there was a Privy Council Court. So Privy Council Court is also useful for the purpose of the judicial decision. So after Supreme Court of India was established, now the Supreme Court judgments are there and Privy Council has been abolished. So therefore, Supreme Court judgments, that is the Indian decisions, are there. I must tell you, as a student of law, our decisions, our Supreme Court judgments are referred in the Asian subcontinent as well as in the South of, in the African continent. And very recently, with reference to even the parliamentary problem in United Kingdom, our judgment, our decisions from India were used. And we are very proud that in the case of Sabharwal, not Sabharwal, Kulbhushan Jadhav in ICJ, the our legal Indian legal brains have been appreciated by the world. So therefore, our decisions are being cited throughout the world, which makes us very proud. Let us go to the next slide. Now, the technology is changing. So therefore, we will have to interpret the current law, interpret the law by applying the present mechanism. I'll give an illustration. When an Indian Evidence Act was created in 1872, at that point of time, there was no typing machine. So therefore, there used to be a handwritten document. But when the typewriting machine came, then automatically we will have to interpret those provisions by meaning, by making reference to the typewriter, because technology has increased, technology has developed. Not only that, when we were getting familiar to the typewriting, then the electronic evidence came. So therefore, now based on the changes in the technology, we will have to interpret the laws in that particular aspect. Please go to the next one. Expiry and repeal of the statute, object of the repeal we can see, express or implied repeal we can see, effect of the repeal we can see, what is the effect. Please go to the next one. I am skipping this because I was given 2 hours time, and since we started at 11:07, so therefore I have almost around 6 or 7 minutes. The General Clauses Act I wanted to avoid, and therefore I kept it as a homework. I requested all of you to download this. These are the four important sections which are with reference to repeal. So you may note down Section 6, that is the effect of the repeal. Section 6A, repeal of the act, how it is to be done. Section 7 says revival of the repeal amendment, how it is to be done. Just see 1897, how our legislators were thinking. So revival of the repeal amendment is also a situation which may occur in future. So therefore, Section 7. Section 8 says construction of the reference to the repeal enactment. Please go ahead. There may be other such enactment where you can make a reference about that repeal provision. So therefore, there is a specific provision about that. Now, this is a new concept about quasi-repeal. Now, this you won't find in a statute book. Quasi-repeal means, I'll give an illustration about the Cantonment Act. Have you heard name of this act? I'm sure no. Because there are no much litigation about the Cantonment Court Act, Cantonment Board Act. In the Cantonment Board Act, which was enacted in 1881, there were certain provisions in respect of which there is no litigation absolutely for years together. So therefore, by efflux of time or by non-user, those have stood quasi-repealed. That is one of the new concepts which has been introduced. Likewise, you must be aware that somewhere in 2015, the central government undertook a big Herculean task of repealing the enactment which have become quasi-repeal. Like several such enactments in which there is no utilization of provisions of that act for years together or decades together, those acts have been repealed. Hundreds of such acts have been repealed by the government of India, and few acts have been repealed by the state of Maharashtra. So therefore, this is known as a quasi-repeal by efflux of the time or non-user or by otherwise. Please go to the next one. Next slide is about the penal statute. In a penal statute, the general rule is the penal statute will have to be implemented strictly. There has to be a strict interpretation of the penal statute. The rule of strict interpretation contemplates that there should be a mens rea. Now, we are aware that what is the meaning of the word mens rea. But the question comes about the vicarious liability, how vicarious liability to be imposed in a penal statute and how it is to be implemented or how it is to be interpreted. This issue, I am keeping this little open. Please go to the next one. Remedial statute, you will find the statute which gives us some remedy to us. Those remedial statute will have to be interpreted with a liberal rule, and a retrospective effect will have to be given to such remedial statute, like creation of some remedy. Like I'll give an example that the Civil Court Act in Maharashtra is concerned, the pecuniary jurisdiction was enhanced. Once the pecuniary jurisdiction was enhanced, then the first appeal from the Honorable High Court were sent back to the district court. So therefore, the question came where whether the cases which were admitted prior in point of time, prior to amendment, will have to be sent back to the district court. The answer was yes. Retrospective effect of remedial statute was made into force, and therefore the all appeals which were admitted before the Honorable High Court, namely the first appeal, were sent back to the district court in the view of the increase in the pecuniary jurisdiction. Next one. That is about the taxing statute. Taxing statute contemplate that there will be a strict interpretation, because there may be a cases of exceptions which are carved out. Qua that also, it will have to be strictly implemented. So strict interpretation is required under the taxing statute. If there is evasion of a tax, again, there is a possibility that there will be a evasion or exemption from the tax, then we are required to consider a strict interpretation. Next slide, please. Now, this is about the Constitution. This is itself is a separate independent topic, but I will just run through the slides. I will not discuss, I will not elaborate. Organic oblique dynamic method, based on the present social situation, Constitution will have to be interpreted. American method says mechanical method, preamble, will have to be interpreted. FR, FD, DPSP, next slide please. These are required to be interpreted. It says the doctrine of doctrines applied in the Constitution. Therefore, I said that this itself will be a separate 2-hour lecture, because pith and substance theory, most of us will not be aware. Most of us may not get any occasion to know what is this pith and substance, colorable legislation. As for want of time, I am not going to go into detail. Incidental and ancillary power under the Constitution, implied power, implied prohibition, occupied field and repugnancy. As I said that go to section 2, article 250, 254, 256, this repugnancy issue will be there. Doctrine of eclipse, delegated legislation. Please go to the next slide. This I am skipping because for want of time I am unable to cover, but you are requested to read this. Please go to the next slide. This is about the subordinate legislation. Subordinate legislation means that the procedural requirement of publication is there. The publication will have to be in advance. Then the procedural requirement is that subordinate legislation will have to be tabled before the parliament. There will be a requirement of consultation, approval, concurrence or permission. I will not go into detail. Please go ahead. In a administrative law, delegated piece of legislation is usually utilized. So therefore, in an appropriate stage, we can do that. There can be conditional legislation. and delegated relationship which can be checked on the touchstone of ultravirus. The delegated legislation, if goes contrary to the main statute, then it becomes ultravirus. If there are breach of principles of natural justice, then it becomes a ultravirus. Please go to the next one. Next one is now new trends in the Indian in the interpretation of statute. Now we are aware that prior to the English East India Company, which came and started ruling on India, we were having our own judicial system, and that is that goes back prior to BC. So therefore, almost more than 3,000 or maybe 4,000 year, we are having our own Indian principle. One of them is Mimamsa rule, that was applied by the Honorable Supreme Court in the year 2006 and 2008. I have mentioned the citations. So therefore, Mimamsa rule of interpretation, which is our own Indian rule, was made applicable. So therefore, this is one of the way how a contribution has been made by India in the interpretation of statute. You will find Mitakshara and Dayabhaga. These were the two schools which are there in Hindus. So therefore, the authors of those schools, or the main person of those schools, is Vijaneshwara and Jimutvahana. So writing of Jimutvahana and Vijaneshwara is also used in the interpretation of statute. This is a contribution made by our own Indian courts, namely the Supreme Courts have started using these new trends. The technological interpretation of statute, this is mostly applied in the European Union courts. So therefore, there is one more new trend of interpretation in statute, that based on the technology, those acts are interpreted and those interpretation of statute is made. So these are the new trends. Next slide, please. And the next slide would be the last slide. I'm sorry, friends, I encroached upon almost 1 or 1.5 or 2 minutes. I'm sorry for the encroachment. The organizers gave me 120 minutes. I spoke about 122 or 123 minutes. Sorry for the encroachment. I hope you must have taken the notes, and this notes will be useful to you in your rest of the life. Now let us open the floor after 30 seconds for answering the questions. In the meantime, let there be a water break.
I request Hemangi Patare madam to express vote of thanks.
I think before that, query should be answered.
Perhaps Sujit is in hurry to close the session.
No, but sir.
I said that I am here to answer if the questions
no,
are
relevant. No, sir.
Relevant.
No, sir. Sir, vote no, of time. No problem. This is normal no trend. Sir, in fact, we express our apologies that the slide could not be loaded in time and we kept waiting.
All right.
Sir, first question is regarding, sir, sub silentio judgment.
Yes. There is a possibility. Whosoever who has raised, I must say, I'm thankful. I could have covered that. There is a habit among honorable judges to lay down something which was not argued or which was not involved in that judgment. Then if such a situation is there, then it is known as the principle of sub silentio. Nobody made submission. Nobody framed a proposition. Nobody called upon the court to adjudicate upon that. Despite that, the enthusiastic honorable judge, if delivers a judgment, then of course that will be a judgment where you will have to say that, sir, this judgment is covered by principle of sub silentio. There is a silence about the proposition, silence about assistance, silence about forming the point for consideration, and therefore please ignore this. Next one.
Sir, this is from our learned advocate friends from Mofussil areas. Can you please suggest some Marathi book for iOS?
मित्रांनो अवघड आहे. कारण सांगतो, याच्या करता इंटरप्रिटेशन ऑफ स्टॅट्यूट हे स्टॅट्यूट बुक नाहीच आहे, आणि ही जी पुस्तक आहे ती इंग्रजी मध्ये आहेत. मी तुम्हाला सांगू का, याच्या करता तर फार सोपं आहे की आपल्याकडची डिफरंट जी जजमेंट आहेत ना, ती आपण त्याप्रमाणे गोळा करायला लागायची. ही स्लाइड शो हा आपल्याकडे ठेवायचा, याच्यामधले वेगवेगळ्या विषयावरचे जजमेंट गोळा करायची, आपली स्वतःची वही तयार करायची. आय एम शुअर इन फ्यू डेज यू कॅन प्रिपेअर युअर ओन बुक which you may publish or may not publish. पण मराठीमध्ये या विषयाकरता चांगलं समृद्ध जजमेंट, चांगलं समृद्ध बुक नाही आहे. इफ यू गो टू पुणे, देन देर आर सम पर्सन्स लाईक त्या अजितवाल्याकडे पुस्तकं मिळतात इंटरप्रिटेशन ऑफ स्टॅट्यूटची, पण त्याचं भाषांतर असतं ते, त्याच्यामुळे दॅट इज नॉट अ गुड बुक सो फार ॲज द इंटरप्रिटेशन ऑफ स्टॅट्यूट आय एम अफ्रेड. त्यामुळे माझ्या लायब्ररीत तरी इंटरप्रिटेशन ऑफ स्टॅट्यूटचं मराठी पुस्तक नाहीये, पण मिळाल्यास आपल्याला मी सांगू शकेल. नेक्स्ट वन
सर, दिस इज रिगार्डिंग इंटरप्रिटेशन ऑफ टॅक्सिंग स्टॅट्यूट. सो अँड व्हॉट आर द एक्सटर्नल एड्स फॉर इंटरप्रिटिंग टॅक्सिंग स्टॅट्यूट?
ओ द सिम्पल वन, टॅक्सिंग स्टॅट्यूट आपल्याला माहिती आहे, टॅक्सिंग स्टॅट्यूट करता जे आपले एक्सटर्नल एडचे जे आपण नियम वापरले, फॉर एक्झाम्पल की इव्हेजन ऑफ टॅक्सच्या करताचा जो काही जॉईंट पार्लमेंटरी कमिटीचा रिपोर्ट येतो, दॅट कॅन बी कन्सिडर एज अ एक्सटर्नल एड. देर कॅन बी ए जजमेंट विच इज डिलिव्हर्ड इन ए ऍडजॉइनिंग कंट्री विच इज अबाउट द सिमिलर प्रोव्हिजन, दॅट कॅन बी कन्सिडर्ड. सो दीज आर द एक्सटर्नल एड. द लॉजिक अँड द रूल विच आर रेड आउट अबाउट द एक्सटर्नल एड इज सेम विथ रेफरन्स टू द टॅक्सिंग स्टॅट्यूट ऑल्सो. नेक्स्ट वन
Sir, this is regarding a mischief rule. So, can you please a little elaborate on mischief rule, because I am getting many queries on mischief rule.
Okay. There are such a situation which the legislators wanted to curb. I will give an example from my own statute way in which I completed my PhD. Garbhatlya mulincha sandarbhatla kayda hai. So, therefore, if there is a child in the womb and if it is allowed to detect the sex of the child in the womb, then there is a possibility that the mother will be compelled to go for abortion or termination of the pregnancy depending on the age of that fetus. So therefore, this is that mischief. So therefore, to curb that mischief, what the legislators have done, the legislators have introduced a provision which says that to curb this kind of a mischief, there should not be communication of the sex of the fetus by words, by sign, or by any other manner to anybody. Now, while interpreting these provisions of law, we have successfully placed into service the mischief rule and said that by any other method includes different innovative methods. So therefore, that is the example which I wish to give, because to cover any other method, we would have to go back to that mischief, and all those mischiefs which are sought to be curbed by the legislation, which are sought to be prevented by the legislation, that will have to be covered, and then we can say that this is a rule of interpretation by virtue of which a mischief rule is introduced. Next.
Sir, this is regarding the pre-constitutional statute, and present scenario, the government is using the Epidemic Act, which is a pre-constitutional, for issuing various directions. So, what is the position of the pre-constitutional statutes regarding its interpretation?
Pre-constitutional statutes were very precise. Pre-constitutional statutes were compact. If you go to this Epidemic Disease Act, you will find hardly three important sections are there. You will find those were precise legislations which were prepared. Therefore, consequentially, for interpretation, there were very, very few questions which were coming. You must be aware that this Epidemic Disease Act was amended by virtue of ordinance last month, a fortnight back. This act was amended for the first time, because during this intervening period, there were no occasion to exercise the power. So therefore, by giving an example, according to me, you are not correct. There are n number of such other pre-independence legislation which are used even today. Like there was a Land Acquisition Act. There is a Transfer of Property Act. There was an old Limitation Act. Several such legislations were there. Arbitration Act 1940 was there. So many such legislations were there, which are interpreted even today. So therefore, we will have to consider the prevailing situation at that point of time, because it was a pre-independence legislation. And by influx of time, whatever the social changes have been made, that will have to be considered. And then the pre-independence legislation where will have to be interpreted. That will be a harmonious rule of construction which can be made applicable. Next one.
Sir, this is more of a feedback. Sir, can you share a case or where there was a rule of interpretation of statutes involved while arguing before a Bombay High Court, and the interpretation of statutes help you get through that case?
Ample. I'll give an example. We are aware that somewhere in 1980 onwards, the private colleges like private polytechnic, private engineering colleges started somewhere in 1980-85. And by flux of time, there is a flood of the engineering colleges. You are aware that last 5 years, the AICT regulatory body was required to put various colleges in the no admission category because the demand supply ratio in the engineering colleges has disturbed drastically and there is an excess supply. So therefore, now a dispute came when the state of Maharashtra was saying that we do not need a engineering college in the state of Maharashtra, but AICT was not closing down several engineering colleges in the state of Maharashtra. In a dispute came up before the Honorable High Court, we pointed out that let us consider who is having a supremacy so far as the opening or cancellation of the engineering college. The we went back to the constitution. In the constitution, in the central act, you will find there is a entry in the central list, namely about the law about the technical education. And in the state list, there is an entry about the education. So engineering college falls in the central list, namely the technical education. So therefore, we said that the state of Maharashtra can't say that close down the engineering colleges. We don't want them. They can give their input to the AICT because AICT is the authority who can grant, who can refuse permission, who can ask the engineering college to close down. I'll tell you, we succeeded. That was a decision against the state of Maharashtra. There are several such examples which we can point out. There is one more example. There was a Consumer Protection Act dispute provision. Section 25 contemplates that a order will have to be sent to the collector for the purpose of execution. The president of the state commission introduced one more circular, and by virtue of that, he went beyond the provisions of the Section 25. We filed a petition in the Honorable High Court. The Honorable Chief Justice was the judge who was dealing with the public interest litigation. On the first date of the hearing, he was satisfied because we said that where is the competence of the Honorable President of the State Commission to issue a guideline or a circular which goes beyond the provisions of the law, namely Section 25. On the first date of hearing, we got a stay, and on the next date of hearing, that was withdrawn. So therefore, this happened last year only. So there are n number of such cases. So in day-to-day practice, if you master about or if you have a sufficient knowledge about interpretation of statute, I'm sure this will be helpful to become a good, successful lawyer in future.
Thank you, sir. Himangi Patari, madam, please take over.
Yes.
Please explain the rule of ejus dem generis.
Ejus dem generis, yes. All right. No difficulty.
Just a minute. There are few queries remain.
Sujit?
Yes, sir.
Can I...
Yes, sir. Please.
I'm having time to.
Sir.
Time to.
Yes.
Yeah. Ejus dem generis. It's almost lunch hour. So therefore, if I place an order in the morning that what is to be made for lunch. So for lunch, if I say that 1, 2, 3, 4, these are the products. These are the items which are required to be prepared. Then in that eventuality, if my wife, who is also a lawyer, if she prepares something more than that, and if that is to be considered, then we will have to see whether the morning instructions were followed or not. The morning instructions were for A, B, C, and she has prepared D also. So therefore, that D will have to be considered in the context of A, B, C. So therefore, A, whether it is in connection with D, B in connection with D, C in connection with D. So this is one of the method which has been provided. And I'm sure that this example is a simple language example. You will find different other legal examples also. But for want of time, I'll not go into detail. Next one, please.
I think, sir, we are done with the queries. Patare, madam.
Yeah. On behalf of Bar Council of Maharashtra and Goa, I am taking this privilege to give thanks to Advocate Dr. Uday Varinjikar sir for enlightening on the very important topic of interpretation of statute, which is definitely going to help our newly enrolled friends. And sir, I am very much sure that my advocate friends are going to take this task of homework assigned by you. Thanks a lot, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Patare madam. Once again, thank you, sir, for taking the pains and preparing a detailed slide. The slides will definitely help the participants in understanding the so-called conflict subject of interpretation, which has been made easy after referring to the slide. Thank you, sir. I think, sir, instructions are already given to the participants. The one set of instructions, whatever homework sir has given, please do that. Nobody is going to check your homework. It is for your own benefit. So don't cheat.